Pensado's Place is brought to you by...
Part two of the Fairfax Recording Special coming right up. We've got a brand new campaign from Isotope. We're in a brand new place. You're at the new place, but damn it, it is Pensado's Place. Brand new.
Man, I can't wait for part two. I've seen part one, but I haven't seen part two.
Right.
I'm really excited about that.
I got to tell you, what's been so fun about doing this, Vintage King making this happen, is I think what I take away from it is how Kevin Augunas has just built upon such a rich history, but he's really making it his own. Mm-hmm. It's kind of like, I find it to be sort of a mecca of musical integrity and artistry and purity, and it's a really special place.
He's continuing the tradition. Yeah. I mean, you think of the records that are coming out of there.
Amazing. And he's got a couple of new acts I just discovered I'm going over to talk to him about.
Oh.
Yeah, they're really cool. So, hey guys, it's great to see you. We're brand new. You can see that some things are different, and they're different because Dave and I have been busy trying to figure out how to take our show to the next place, this incredible gift that you've given us. And one of the things started with was finding a brand new studio, and we've done that. We are now at the stream.tv studio, smack dab in the heart of Hollywood. Susan Wren and Lorna have just been incredible hostesses, and they run a very smart business. And we're going to be able to do a lot more shooting, bring you a lot more content. So you have wrought this upon us. Please continue by liking and subscribing. It works. Yeah, it really does work.
Does.
We'd be remiss if we didn't shout out to the folks at the Art Institute. Thank you for our time there. Mark Lowentrout and Joe Barrera in particular, yeah, are our friends. They have
Absolutely.
Our back 100% of the way. They stood in the face of some fire and made it happen, and we are proud of them.
The team, including them, we made some great shows over there.
We did.
And,
we did.
Nothing but good memories.
Fond memories. And shout outs to the students. We have several students who were absolute standouts. We got a bunch hired. We've actually taken one with us with our crew. So we love, thank you for that transition. Our show grew very fast, and now we're at a new place. So moving forward, shout outs to our Vintage King and Avid family. Vintage King is sponsoring this second part of this special, obviously the first part as well too. Great stuff going on with them. And by the way, it's their 20th anniversary. Great work from Andrew and Michael, who are musicians from their heart,
yeah,
and just brought
flies
it forward. Team Avid, we're shooting a great deep dive into Pro Tools 11.
I'm looking forward to that.
In a couple days.
Yeah.
We're
going to
shoot
fun.
That. Yeah, it's going to be cool, right?
Yeah.
We're gathering an expert group of panels, We're
going to
do that second. Yeah. We're going to shoot that at Dave's room and give you a look at that and talk and drill down. We're bringing in some folks to talk about it. That's going to be very cool. And lastly, our good friends in Boston, Massachusetts. You did a, last week, I think you did a ITL on the RX3.
I love that stuff.
How much of a beast is that?
It's a beast. Like I told you, I rip off a lot of samples off of songs I like, and mm-hmm, sometimes you're stuck with like a little sound you don't like.
Mm-hmm.
Takes it right out.
Just deals with it.
Yeah. There was a time in our history where we used their plugins to clean up our show.
There was. Very recently.
We put them out of business. We don't have that problem anymore.
So here's what they came up with, which is pretty cool. They're going to, for the month of October, give away a bunch of different things.
Mm-hmm.
Stuff like Trash and Iris and Ozone 5.
They're giving us away?
They're giving us away.
I see our pictures.
Alloy 2. Well, we have something that's a choice. So each week, if you go to pensadosplace.tv/isotope, enter your email there, we will pick some names, and each week we're going to do something like this. We're going to take the wheel, and we're going to spin it, as you see there. And as we spin it, we'll come up, and somebody will win a mix and master bundle, or they'll win a Ozone 5.
Ooh.
So we're going to have a lot of fun with that. They're really great guys, and
yeah,
make sure you do that.
Talented staff.
Other than that, my friend, why don't you toss to the part two of the Fairfax recording special?
Okay. I'm looking forward to seeing this. Part one got us going through the live part of it. Now we're going to go into another part of the studio. Hope you enjoy it. The foundation of Vintage King is musicians selling equipment to musicians. Vintage King started with Mike and Andrew purchasing gear for themselves, and then Mike got a little bit out of control, somewhat of a hoarder situation, and found himself bartering, trading, and at the foundation of everything was to just be around vintage gear and be around incredible gear, some new, some vintage, just incredible. Guys, you guys started out in a band. You started out as musicians in a band, and then ultimately, like every band, you wanted to record yourselves, and you started out pretty basic, right, Mike? Take me to those early days. Let's call this PVK, pre-Vintage King, but take me rapidly up to Vintage King.
All right, so quickly, I mean, it started in my parents' basement. I built a 4-track studio when I was 17, and then that turned into an 8-track, 16-track half-inch, and then Andrew came into the picture then, and we started playing together, and we moved the studio down to downtown Detroit, which became White Room Studio.
What instrument do you play?
Guitar. Andrew plays bass and cool. drums and stuff. And
oh, you play drums too? Cool. Yeah.
You wanted to try everything to figure out what it all sounded like, because you read about it, you heard about it, and I was so crazy, I would go to the library to read Recording Producer Engineer, because there was nowhere to, there was no videos to learn about this. There was no, you know,
internet.
Your show wasn't around, there's no internet. So I had to go to libraries.
My show wasn't
to, oh, I know, it was back in the dark age.
It was me in my basement with an 8mm camera and Herb and
coming up with a few things. Right. No, but you'd go, and that's how I would research and read about these, you know, great records being made. Was I'd go to the library and read these old article issues that were still there. So anyhow, I'd start buying, and my brother and I, we would here and there. You'd afford to buy a Poltech or a mic or, you know, 47 or something, and that. And then that turned into a business because we started to obtain more of it from England. The exchange rate was good.
How did you know to buy Poltech back then? I didn't even know what that was.
Because I read it in the magazine.
REP?
REP, yep. And maybe the studio, it was in town in Detroit. I'd go in and I'd see it. And then that led, I was on various groups that were on various labels at the time. Uh-huh. I was lucky enough when I was 20, 21, 22 to be on a few different major labels. And I would be in the studio with, I mean, a lot of great recording engineer, producer types that are well known, you know, these days. And I'd be in there. And I was, for instance, in Sound City in 83, I was with John Boylan. He was producing the group Shy Talk I was on. And he had just, I know he had done Boston in the 70s. It was pretty big back then in the 80s. And and Paul Grupp, he brought us in to record it because of the drum sound. So part of what you guys are all experiencing and all, you know, the Sound City movie and all that, I felt like watching that was pretty cool because I was actually part of that in the 80s. The band was never popular, but hey, I still got to record
but you got
here.
To Sound City.
I did, man.
And
I got to record.
You're at Fairfax Recordings.
Right, exactly. Right. So to see Kevin, who, to fast track, you know, Vintage King all kind of got rolling with my brother and I in the mid 90s, and we were producing and engineering. Kevin started calling, you know, to buy some things as our client.
Were you Vintage King then?
We were Vintage King then. We were advertising the back of Mix magazine pre-internet days. Yeah. And Kevin was dabbling the same way. So we were going through this kind of disease sickness with experimenting, and Kevin started to come along and start experimenting. And I think we, you know, that was a cool part of it is, a, you know, it wasn't just a client. We became friends because we were interested in the same craziness and just trying things because you just wanted to know what it all sounded like. And you had to try it all in order to do that. You had to experiment with all these different models and compressors that you'd read and heard about on these great records. You wanted to know, why did they use it? So that led to Kevin's, you know, more and more of him trying, experimenting, and kind of we gave Kevin a carte blanche to really try pretty much everything he wanted. And Kevin, I guess you could take it from here on that part of your life, you know, the evolvement from there, you know.
Yeah, it's funny, just you talking about it, I'm reliving when we first started doing stuff together, which I believe was about 97, if I remember.
Reliving, does that mean you didn't pay for everything and now you're feeling guilty about it?
Oh, I paid for it.
Okay, you did. Just checking. I got to help out the brothers.
Yeah, totally.
Got to keep that revenue stream going.
No, so it's interesting you bring that up, because I can remember seeing the Vintage King logo, the ad, like a business card size ad in the back of Mix
Black
magazine. And I remember I had a very similar experience. So I started off as a musician also, cut my teeth or learned about the stuff being in a band, playing bass in bands, and going in a studio and then, you know, plugging in a Fairchild or a Pultec and just, whoa, you know, hearing that stuff, hearing the difference. Yeah. And then at some point when I started doing more producing or recording the bands I was in, needing gear, and I remember ordering gear from a few different boutique vintage dealers. They were one of them. I ordered a couple pieces from a couple other people, and honestly, and this is not an advertisement because we're here, but you guys were the best to deal with, and what they represented, they had. I think the first thing I bought was a 47, and back then they were not much money, or a lot less than they are now.
Right.
But they sent me a real 47. And I didn't know the difference. And they sent me one with a proper capsule, proper power supply. I ordered stuff from a few other people, and what came wasn't exactly what was represented to me.
Wow.
So, and I was dealing directly with Mike at that time, because I don't know how many people were working at the company.
Right. What year? Andrew and I and another person.
What year was it?
97 is my memory.
Yeah. Let me ask you,
did you have a staff of 15 techs checking everything back then?
No, we had a technician or two.
Well, now you got 15 ticks.
It was much smaller, and it's evolved and
where
grown.
Where did that mic come from? Somebody traded it in?
We used to buy a lot of them from Europe at that point, because they were still a lot over there, and the exchange rate was such that...
You'd travel to Europe, and like antique dealers do, and scout out stuff?
In the beginning, Andrew and I did, couple years before we met Kevin, maybe 3-4 years before.
Yeah.
When we started, we didn't know where it was leading to. We just went there to buy for ourselves, and we happened. You know, we started with a credit card, $2,000. We didn't have any money. This wasn't an inherited business, so we started with $2,000 in credit cards. Went there, bought $2,000 worth of vintage gear, and just kept doing it. We paid it. The guy got okay. These guys are cool, and I would keep calling back the people we'd met over there, various dealers. And they didn't have everything we wanted at the time, but I'd call them and say, come on, do you have any 1073s? You got any AKGs? And they started saying, yeah, we do. I'd always pay on time. We do everything the right way. And they kept calling us, and it snowballed into that.
Dude, I just remembered an insane story. I don't know if you remember this.
Right?
I swear this happened. So one of the second or third things we did together, I was in the studio working with the band, and they had a Elam 251, and our singer singing into it, and I'm just like, my gosh, this mic sounds incredible.
Right.
So I call up Mike, and I go, do you have one of these AKG 251s? And he goes, yeah, as a matter of fact, he happened to have one that was in brand new condition, still had its tags on it,
right.
And he just sent it to me. Like, I didn't pay for it or anything. Don't try this at home, because I'm sure you're doing it. But he sent it to me, and I remember, this is the funny part to me, I remember plugging it in, and I didn't know what I was doing.
Right.
I plugged it in, and for whatever reason, I didn't think it sounded very good, but I didn't know any better.
Were you singing into it yourself?
Probably. So I sent it back, and we didn't know each other that well yet. And I remember calling you a week or two later. I was like, yeah, I don't know about that mic. It just didn't sound like it. And you're like, that's cool. Keith Richards just bought it, so it's all good.
Whoa.
And then I remember feeling so small, like, clearly I don't know what I'm doing.
That's hilarious. So you know it, too. You're touching on it.
That's a good story.
Hold on. If you've heard him sing, you can probably understand why he bought it.
Yeah, that's fun. No, but I think what you were touching on, Kev, is kind of the same experience we had, because Mike and I didn't have any money. We were starting the studio. And we were in a group on EMI, and we wanted to record our own music, but Mike started to buy vintage gear. But what happened was the people that were selling gear at the time, or the dealers or brokers as we called them, didn't really own the gear. So they would find out what you want, they would source it, and basically never even see it. And so then you'd receive something. And Mike and I, you know, we'd bought something and received, you could receive a box of rocks, and they'd be like, well, sorry.
I received an MXR Flanger, those little skinny blue ones, and it didn't work. And I'm like, I call the guy back, goes, why? I shipped it. It worked.
Right. So you're kind of left in the cold. So what we started to do is, you know, we just started to use that money to funnel our habit. We didn't take any money. It wasn't for making money. It was for making, getting a gear collection. Mm-hmm. And so at that time, we would just sell something, immediately buy more gear, and just kept doing that. But what we really were trying to promise to ourselves, to the people we were purchasing from and the people we were selling to, was that, we're never going to be those guys who are just going to send you something and sorry you're stuck with it. We're going to just do the right thing and treat people the right way. And that's not something that needs to be manufactured, or we had to think about our marketing plan. We were just like, that's just what people do.
That's how you do business, right?
Or just how you treat people, whatever you do.
That's the foundation of what I think Vintage King is still about. Take me to the transition from turning loose of the artist record deal dream and understanding that Vintage King was going to be the main focus of your life. Was that a gradual transition?
Yeah. When you live at your parents' house when you're 33 because you're trying to produce records and fulfill your dream and be an artist, and then I'm just discovering that I can't, I couldn't live anymore. I'm doing this thing at White Room with my brother, and we've had record deals, and none of the bands were really that successful until we hit this Robert Bradley's Blackwater Surprise thing, which was pretty successful.
More so in a critical way.
But that was like the pinnacle. Like, we got to use all the great gear and really made some real solid records, and it was critically acclaimed. But then still, though, I couldn't make a living. I couldn't just eat off that. Okay, yeah. So at that point,
we were lucky, just to interrupt. I mean, we were touring. We were doing good tours, from the Allman Brothers to maybe a Lenny Kravitz day to Medeski, Martin Wood, to whatever. We had a lot of bands who loved us. MTV was really helping us out because they tried to find a back road in for us to swim upstream. So we were just really doing what a band does. You get on the road, mm-hmm. and you tour to your death.
Can you remember? Can you remember what your gross income was? From Vintage King, MTV year?
We didn't take anything from Vintage King. We used to just reinvest it. We used just to buy gear. It was all to just make the studio a better environment, for us to have great gear.
Do pictures exist of White Room anywhere?
Yeah.
No, for sure. Yeah. And we had kind of looked like Kevin's when you walked in your place 10 years ago.
Dude, I have pictures of your tech shop on my computer right now from the first time I ever came there.
Are you serious?
In 97. He had an amazing light green Decca console that he found.
Right. Yeah.
And I flew out to see that.
That was
sick. And I have pictures from that whole trip. Yeah. Yeah.
Those compressors are still our Mike and I's favorite. Like, when we... Mike started to learn about it, and he flips these compressors on, you're like, what? This is the Beatles, or Zeppelin, or you're hearing this tone of compressed drums for the first time. But what we were doing, we were traveling and running Vintage King. Mike would be on a payphone. I'd be stalling the band while he's on the payphone. The band's getting pissed off because they're waiting.
And I'd be talking to Kevin or whoever about gear, and I'd be hustling gear, and but anyhow, like you said, how much do we make? It wasn't about making money. It was just about the money just to buy more gear.
Right.
So it was just a big gear fest, right. And it was, and after a while, it got to the point
more
where,
like a gear expo.
A gear expo.
Yeah.
But it was, we didn't think about it. We were just having fun, man. And it was we were living the dream and touring, creating our studio with the Vintage Gear and all that, and producing records. It was fun. So anyhow, it got to the point where Vintage King started to become, the success became, it started to grow, and it was hard to handle it all. And kind of the group we were in on RCA kind of started to phase out, and I started to realize that I can't, you can try to maintain a career in that and persevere. And like watching Kevin for 15 years or actually a little more, go through his career, look how long it's taken you to get to this point. It was not an overnight climb, so you have to have a lot of perseverance. We happened to cross into a business that started to take off, so you had to make the choice.
Yeah.
Am I gonna?
It was sort of natural, because we were still playing a lot of music, and then at that point too, then you finally get into the bus, you're doing these kick-ass tours, and then you're still up at night doing this work too. But we just kind of looked at it as like a little bit of a blessing. Here we were, playing music, we had this thing that just grew naturally, and we just felt like, it was just part of what we did. What I mean?
Kevin actually produced the band at one point?
No, we never.
We met Kevin after the band. kind of the band
he
was
never
in the
engineered mid- for you or something. I thought he did.
No, we I think we just had a respect. He had his thing going on with
the band was still going on because we would talk and you would be like, "Oh, I'm going to be in New York," or I'd be because I was going back and forth.
Right. You were going back in New York.
I saw you guys play many times. Yeah. So we were I was getting stuff from you and you were still on the road.
And I
you're right.
Honestly, I mean, it would actually be a pleasure to have recorded with Kevin because the way, you know, his philosophy of how he records.
You would, you wait, real. If you recorded with me, you probably wouldn't say that.
The cool thing is, though, seriously, hearing what Kevin's doing now in the way, and I'm not just saying this because we're here, but Andy and I, we worked very simply with not many. After a while, you know, you have all this glut of gear and you just strip down to, okay, less is more. Just give me a great, you know, performance, song, mic pre, mic, placement right spot, few mics, and just it all comes together and it just sounds big. And that's all I ever want to do is make things sound big, but not in a, I don't mean in a big bass way, but in a not much going on, but takes up a lot. It just has a lot of size within the three dimension of space.
You touched on something that I think is kind of germane to the discussion today, the fact that that at some point you can have too much gear and you actually have to kind of pare it down in terms of your personal use. I'm not talking in terms of Vintage King. But.
I know for me, so early on when I met Mike and Andy, it was definitely a matter of wanting to experience a bunch of different types of gear.
Mm-hmm.
And so I was very fortunate, again, to have that relationship with them at Vintage King, because Mike would funnel me a lot of stuff to try out with, mm-hmm. with no obligation of keeping it, but a lot of stuff I would keep and buy. So yeah, there was a point I'd say from, you know, 97 to 2005 where I was just acquiring stuff and using it as much as possible on any recording I could.
When we say a lot of gear, kind of just give me a feel for what, like how many, just give me some examples.
Oh my gosh. It's
Can I talk?
It's obnoxious.
Yeah. 4 to 6 Fairchild 660s.
No.
2 to 3 670s, 8 to 10 to 12 Pultex. And
that's illegal.
But not, you know, you'd see it and you'd come in though, and it wasn't, it seemed crazy.
It wasn't.
It was just Kevin, he did it. I don't know. I mean, look at the recording room. It's just, he just does it right. But he stripped down. So go ahead, Kev, tell us why you stripped down.
So it would be, I had multiples of a lot of things. But usually to try them out and find which one, if any of them, I liked the sound of. And then I would...
Each one had a unique sound, unique application.
I'd get rid of the other things. So, again, it was just my way of giving myself an education or supplementing an education on gear. If I had gone the traditional route and maybe been lucky enough to be a runner or an intern at a studio, I could have had that experience without having to purchase things.
Mm-hmm,
right. It just didn't exist for me and it's not how I came about. So I'd kind of go through that and then amass a certain amount of stuff. And then when I felt I had enough experience with those things and I was confident and comfortable enough to start letting things go, I slowly started letting things go and sending them back to these guys.
You were producing records at this point in time, right?
Oh yeah, definitely. And so I started, you know, whittling my collection down. I did so many, besides just buying individual pieces of gear, I think early on, at two different times, I bought 2 or 3 different Neve consoles from Mike and then would redo them myself to figure out how to do it and then get them to work and then move them on. And to, you know, we bought an EMI console out of Abbey Road together in the late 90s and I used that for years to record and mix on.
And that was a pretty legendary desk. And I think for Kevin, it was the centerpiece of his former studio. It was a 40 input, one of the two, what we call the dark side of the moon desks, you know, that era, right, Kev? The 40 channel winged consoles and pretty, you know, the TGI 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 desk.
It was amazing. I mean, when Mike called me and he's like, look, this desk is available. It's in boxes, it's in pieces, it's over in Europe, but it's there, you know, I'm calling you first. Are you interested in it? I was like, yeah. It's funny. I think I had just bought my first house, and I leveraged myself in the most dangerous way to buy that board.
Right.
But yeah. I had to have it.
Yeah. Yeah.
But it was a great experience because we put it together. Mm-hmm. We spent a lot of time putting it back together. We actually brought Brian Gibson, who was the head tech at Abbey Road in the 60s and 70s, brought him over from England. He helped us put it back together because there were some schematics for it, but not all of them.
Right.
And it was a great experience because we used it. I used it for a good amount of years, made a lot of records on it. And then
I remember hearing about when you got that console. It was that big a news in the industry.
It was such a wonderful board. But then when I was done with it,
I called
Mike up and he found the next home for it, and that's where it is now. And so all those experiences kind of lead me to where I am now, which is I have a much smaller amount of gear. Mm-hmm. It's very specific to my needs.
Mm-hmm. You're now venturing into creating your own gear, and obviously it's going to reflect your taste, which is a function of having all that gear. Is it safe to say that some of the new equipment you're working with and developing is a synthesis of all this gear that you had your hands on in the past?
Absolutely.
And you're taking the best, in terms of your opinion, the best of each, and take me through that process.
Okay, well, for instance, over the years, our new compressor is the first thing we've been working on for the studio.
Mm-hmm.
And there's components in this compressor or things that it does, applications that you can use it for, that come from a small handful of compressors. For instance, I'm a huge Fairchild fan. Who isn't? They're amazing. Mm-hmm. You get a good one, they're great. The Gates, I love the Gates compressors, the old Gates compressors.
Stay Level?
Yeah, the Stay Level. And
the Level Devil?
Some of the bigger ones.
Mm-hmm.
And then I really am a huge fan of LA3s, and mm-hmm. actually one of my favorite compressors is a DBX Over Easy, a 165.
Yeah.
Amazing.
Yeah. That's an underrated vocal compressor for sure.
Absolutely. And a good friend of mine, a really amazing engineer, turned me on to that and kind of spun my head because I was using Fairchild.
That was one of the original VCA-based compressors, wasn't mm-hmm. it?
I think so, yeah.
Yep.
So this is the end result of culmination of all of that.
Yeah.
Take me through this and as it relates to some of the things that you have synthesized into this from your experiences with all the stuff that Mike and Andrew gave you.
All right. So well, I'm about to say it's pretty straightforward, although there is a lot on it. Tried to make an all-in-one box. My friend Jeff Terzo, who has Overstayer recording equipment, it's a newer company, designed this. I kind of gave him a list of wants and needs, and he's a brilliant, brilliant designer, mm-hmm. and he put this together. But so from the old school standpoint, as far as reaching back to the Fairchild stuff or the Gate stuff, mm-hmm. I'd say that's more the input and output transformers that will supply that kind mm-hmm. of sound. It is a solid state compressor, mm-hmm. but I believe a lot of that sound comes from the transformers.
It would be fair to say it has a little bit of lineage to the 1176 then?
It could a bit, although that wasn't the intention.
More the LA3?
More the LA3. I mean, maybe where the attack and release are looks right. similar to the 1176. So the things we incorporated into this that I feel that I wanted that I didn't find anywhere else, a big one for me is there's a built-in de-esser, which is huge for me to be able to de-ess something properly after mm-hmm. compressing it a certain amount.
That's cool.
And also, it's basically a compressor mixer, if that makes any sense.
No, it doesn't.
Okay, so you put a signal in. You have a limiter,
mm-hmm.
you have a compressor section,
mm-hmm.
you have a direct blend, and mm-hmm. you have a de-esser.
Mm-hmm.
So you can run all these things in series. You can actually limit your signal, compress
it. This is a selection for the de-essing frequencies?
Yes.
Okay, I got you now.
So you can limit, compress, and de-ess, and, mm-hmm. and blend in a dry signal.
All at the same time.
Oh, I got you.
Pretty
right? That's the mixer thing.
Right. Or you can run them in parallel, one way or the other. One can follow the other.
No.
Or you can do them in series.
Wow.
But what
Where's that switch?
It is right here. Comp limit or limit comp are in the middle. It's in series.
Dave, there's no show wow. compliments either for you or anything.
But
man, I just like being, I just want my picture took with it.
Yeah. One thing I
like they say back home.
One thing I was always doing with mixing is, and I think a lot of people do these days, is, you know, you have your, let's say you have your dried your dry drum mix, mm-hmm. but then you want a compressed drum mix to kind of blend it in,
absolutely.
Right?
Absolutely.
But sometimes every time. But sometimes when I work with the older gear, like the EMI console okay. or some other old consoles I've had, you get that there's a delay, and it creates phasing. So when you bring it, or if you put it through certain old compressors, mm-hmm. and you bring it back, okay. mm-hmm. that certain amount of delay creates a bad phase. You've probably experienced
every
that.
Every time.
Right. This so. To me, this was a great way to be able to blend a direct signal and a, let's call it an affected signal. Mm-hmm. And we've all experienced, you know, when you compress, let's say, drum overheads a lot and stuff gets sibilant or cymbals or vocals. That's why one of the DS are built in.
So you designed it around more so drums, or can you dial in the frequency for vocals or?
It's designed to work on all that stuff.
15456, is that the name of it?
It is, it's called a 15456 peak limiter. It's the address here.
We don't want people showing up.
You know, just historically speaking,
that's
too.
Cool.
We were talking earlier that a lot of the early studios, Abbey Road or EMI, BBC, all was commissioned. You know, the studios at that time, they didn't have necessarily the gear that they imagined.
Very true.
And they also imagined gear. So, you know, you were a studio, you built your gear, which is really cool. Kevin is cycling back to having the record label, having the studio facility and all that, and kind of getting back to the nucleus of what is it that he's personally searching for, and making it simple, and then building what his vision is.
Good point.
You know, that's a pretty dramatic, you know.
It's natural for Kevin, though, too, I think.
Yeah.
You've tried all this, and you're coming full circle. You're making brilliant records, and you're about to release some great products. So.
I'm going to put you guys on the spot here, because I know that it's cool that you said that, Andrew, because one of the things I love about Vintage Steve. King is that when you guys see someone that has a talent in terms of manufacturing equipment, or when you see a piece of equipment that captures your imagination and you think is unique, you guys support those people and you support that equipment. Yeah. You gonna support this?
Yeah. I think so. You know, it's remain, but I'm sure we'll be helping Kevin on that. But no, that's a really good point.
I love that about Vintage King because a lot of people don't know that there might not be Barefoot Monitors if it weren't for your support of that company and those people. One of our favorites, Mr. Reardon, with Shadow Hills. We love that guy.
Yeah.
Is it safe to say that he might have struggled without your help?
Yeah, I think it was a great relationship. I think, you know, Vintage King, when Mike and I started Vintage King, and as Kevin can attest to, and even yourself, at that time, it was the only reason why we sold only vintage was because that was really the only thing we thought that was really, for our taste, good.
Mm-hmm.
And so there wasn't really options out there for us to sell.
It was a different world, though, wasn't it?
There wasn't a lot of great new gear, and we put it kind of in piles. You know, there's some great new gear, there's a lot of good new gear, and there's a lot of stuff over there. Mm-hmm. We like to deal with the great stuff, and you know, there's some good things that are still okay. You know, it's all a matter of taste how you're using it, right?
Right. Mm-hmm.
So I think. Where what you're saying, say Barefoot, Shadow Hills, Retro Instruments, a lot of lines we've been, you know, Inward Connections, bringing Helios over here. We've been in, you know, from sale number one of those companies till now, they're all, you know, very developed, you know, good sized audio manufacturers. And I think if I can just finish, Kevin, where he goes with this, we're going to take him wherever he wants to go with it. You know what I mean? It depends where he wants it to be. But I think the cool thing about Kevin, he just wants to release a few things that have a lot of meaning to you and how you want them to sound.
Yeah.
And we'll support that. So I'm really excited.
And right now, we strictly built these for our use. I don't, beyond that, I'm not sure what's going to happen. But we've built them to fit our needs.
I got a feeling they're going to do well because it the lineage of everything that came before it is in it.
Right.
I mean, in a philosophical way.
And I wanted to comment too that, you know, Vintage King in the history, so we would sell all these, you know, API, Neve, whatever it was that we had our hands on during that time. We invigorated sort of, you know, there's obviously people interested in these things. We weren't the only ones on the planet, but kind of invigorated, I think, and inspired a lot of the the manufacturers, because they started to see that we were selling a lot of this refurbished vintage gear, and then that's where Mike, you know, and we would speak with these companies, Mike and I, and try to get them to maybe remanufacture some part numbers or
re-release and so forth.
Re-release things and that, and then kind of give the opportunity to a lot of guys who had dreams to build gear and artistically have an outlet to be able to start a business. Mm-hmm. And that's where it's really cool. It's been an exchange. You know, we couldn't do it without these people thinking of these great ideas. And we've been really, you know, happy and grateful that we could kind of create a platform for that.
I was privy to that time period and you're being very modest. I think you guys had a significant contribution to the resurgence of the understanding that vintage gear has a place everywhere in every studio, and the fact that you supported some of the newer versions of vintage gear. Yeah. That's pretty impressive.
Thank you.
In fact, we all owe you a little bit of thanks for that. You know, there were other people too. You guys certainly did that. Kev, when can we expect this?
Oh, I have no idea. Again, right now we're just using them here, and we're really enjoying what they do, and we'll see where the future goes with them. I don't know.
Well, what's next after this? Are you gonna continue this?
Yeah, we're working on our own EQ right now, based off of a few different EQs we like. It's kind of based off of the Altec Graphic EQ that's in the board, and also some Pultec features. So I think we're going to build our own EQ, and we're working on our own ribbon mic.
Let's take a look at the board over there. That's an old Altec. Can't remember the number.
Yeah, this is an old Altec 9200. And this board, as far as we can tell, was built sometime in the mid late 60s.
Okay.
It was ordered and built for Owen Bradley's barn in Nashville. A lot of the components say Bradley's barn on them inside of it. We spent a good year or so refurbishing it. I had Ken Hirsch over at Orphan Audio here in town.
Oh yeah,
refurbished this whole thing, and it did a really wonderful job.
I like his work on the Harrison stuff.
Yeah, Ken's great. He's got a talented guy, talented group of people. It's a really simple, straightforward board. I describe it as kind of a dragster. You know, there's no power windows, there's no stereo.
That's so funny. Just a complete total non sequitur. The vibe's getting too good. Let me slow it down. Don Garlitz was one of my neighbors, Big Daddy guy, Don Garlitz. If you know anything about drag racing.
Okay.
So everybody knows what a big fan of knobs I am. Those are just some great knobs.
Yeah.
The little bitty kind of that look like the little. What do those do?
So these right here, these are the EQs. So these are your frequency selectors up here, and then this is just your cut. I'm sorry, your boost and your cut.
Okay,
so simple.
It's really straightforward. Yeah.
Kev, how many frequencies do you have for EQ?
There is four for the high end, and there's two for the bottom. I think there's 140 cycles on the bottom, 15, 10, 5, and 3 on the top.
In being such a bare control room, which is so cool, how do you, when you have frequencies that you got to deal with in between those, how do you deal with them?
You know, it's really funny. Being in this room,
right?
You know, the room to me is the biggest part of the sound. But being in this room, we rarely EQ anything. I mean, we really don't.
It sounds so good.
It's funny. We have very powerful EQs, in my opinion. I think, you know, like you're saying, to other people, maybe they're kind of broad. They're definitely not surgical.
Mm-hmm.
But we kind of subscribe more to moving the microphone around as a first choice, as opposed to just wrenching the frequencies, right? So we'll try and choose the right mic, move it around, use our ear.
Yeah.
It usually works.
Yep.
And at the most, maybe I'm adding some 10K just to open things up a little bit. And very broad 10K, right? That's it, man. I mean, there's...
Did you do the Lumineers on this board?
Yeah. So I mixed the Lumineers record on the monitor section over here. Mm-hmm. Which, again, the monitor section was just an extension of the board. So the monitor section is not vintage. When we remodeled the board, or restored it. This is the original monitor section. So it's a 8-channel monitor section, and we're using a 16-channel tape machine.
Some people aren't, most people today are familiar with the classic SSL inline concept for a console. Mm. Explain when this console was made, the record side was one side, and then you listen to it, the monitor side, separately. So right. When you say the monitor section, explain that to our audience.
Okay, yeah. So in the traditional sense, or the classic sense, the board, the recording side would kind of be over here. Here's your 16 channels of recording. Here's your buses that you use to send signal out. And then you'd have your monitor section on the end, or your return section. Mm-hmm. And as you mentioned, with more modern consoles, it's inline, where you can really make them as flexible as you want and design it any way you can. But back in the day, they switched it up. So you literally moved from left to right. We're going to record here. These are our mics. It's going to go to the tape machine, and then it's going to return back here to the monitor section.
Kevin, a person that never used a console like this, but that is a little more familiar with, say, the digital world, it's hard to describe sound, and I'm not going to ask you to do that, but what are your expectations from a console like this sonically? I mean, what is it that you get from this that you can't get from any other place?
This board is really clean, but it's really aggressive at the same time. And I know
clean
that...
Clean meaning?
Not a lot of distortion to my ear.
That seems anathema to the concept of using analog vintage gear.
There's different kinds of distortion, right?
So, gotcha.
It to my ear, it sounds, this is the only way I can, it's very late 60s clean, like a late 60s Marvin Gaye record or I'll Be Around type.
So it's probably got a lot of separation because it's, like you say, if it's forward and aggressive a bit, it's got nice separation.
Yeah, it's warm and big sounding, but it's clean. It's mm-hmm. I have my outboard tube stuff to make stuff a little woolier sounding. Mm-hmm. To me, you can, the simplest sense and the most modern day sense, so everybody understands it.
Yeah.
Pretty much everybody's got Instagram now, right?
Yeah.
You take a photo with Instagram,
sure.
And then you get a choice of filters at the bottom. There's your sepia tone.
Right.
There's your clear photo. Right, there's your black and white.
Yeah.
There's no better or worse. There's just whatever the user feels is appropriate for the moment.
Exactly. Yep.
Exactly.
And I don't think one's better or worse. And I feel that way about digital and analog because I've heard amazing records made on both.
Right.
This monitor section is new. This thing was put together, it started with a conversation between me and my friend Mark Neal, who's an amazing engineer producer, and Ken Hirsch, and we all kind of came up with what this monitor section should be, and then Ken implemented it up at Orphan Audio, and that's how this came about. And all this is a panel with faders and pots. It's super simple. And then amps at the summing bus.
Okay.
It's as simple as that. It's just, when I mix, it's just setting levels and deciding whether it's going to be left, center, or right. I just, for me, for my ear, I don't need things at
in between
varying degrees. I try and pick a point and then stick with it. Right. The reverb return is just a mono return. We have an echo chamber, we have plates, and we have a couple spring reverbs, and we just choose whatever reverb is the most appropriate. So usually I run that tape machine for slap.
Okay.
Or echo of any kind,
yeah.
And then a chamber. And I either run them one on pre and one on post, or we do the classic, use that as pre-delay for the reverb.
Okay.
And it's the panning is that simple. It's just that easy. And if you want things to move across the image, you just bring two faders up and put one left, one right, and you manually do this. And that's, as you know, that's how you can move stuff across.
Mm-hmm.
I don't really do that. Not because I don't like it, it's just not something I do.
Yeah.
Yeah, I just, stuff doesn't move around too much for me.
Okay.
So you did the Lumineers on this one.
Yeah, we mixed the Lumineers record on this monitor section, and oddly enough, it was the first thing I mixed on this when this thing was done being built. They installed it, and then 2 days later, the Lumineers showed up, and...
That's a great sounding record.
I just did it.
That's a great sound.
It's 2 foot
loves
wide.
That record.
Right.
It's great.
What'd you say, Mike?
It's 2 foot wide. This mixing section that Kevin used. I love it.
How many tracks were on that on the Lumineers record? Was it 16 track?
Yeah, maybe less.
That Scully over there. Is that the one you used?
Well, the record came in digitally because they had recorded it with a producer up in Washington. Mm. So when it came in, we kind of dug through the record, more reduced it a bit, like took tracks out, and then did a few overdubs, a few vocal overdubs and percussion stuff. Mm. And then since it was already in the digital format, just ran it from there and then mixed it to tape, though.
Okay.
Mixed it down to two track.
To be completely candid with you, I didn't notice if it was digital or analog. It just sounded great.
Yeah.
It just sounded great, which I think is what we're all striving for, is just to create something that gives people 3 or 4 minutes of escape from the problems of the world today. And you let the songs come through like gangbusters, and I think that's one of your biggest gifts. I think the gear helps you do that. But you master the gear. It never seems to master you. Well, I went Southern on you just then. I went Duck Dynasty on that one.
But you know, I mean, again, you're an amazing mixer yourself. So you know.
I was fishing pretty hard for that. I'm glad you picked up on it.
Our job in those situations, in my opinion, is recognizing that something's great and basically getting out of the way.
Yeah.
Right.
And just helping it where it needs help, not reinventing the wheel.
Right.
Yeah. It's just getting out of the way when something's like, oh gosh, this is amazing, let me help it. And then, because, that's just how
I think. What are some of the recent projects you've done here?
So I have a band on the label called Red, Gold, Green.
Yeah, that's what it is.
Right. So it's more of, they're a DC, Washington, DC based.
Like, very cool stuff.
Go-go band.
I love Chuck Brown. Ooh.
Yeah.
He just passed recently, you know.
I know. That was during while we were making the record, I think. But
the king of go-go music.
That was a really fun one because they're a great group of guys. They wrote a bunch of great songs. And it just everything happened at the right time. The band came in. They didn't have a drummer. And they're from D.C. And I was in the middle of doing stuff with Dave Grohl because he was wanting to make a movie about the studio. Mm-hmm. And then one day I just called Dave up. I'm like, man, I got this band from D.C.
You can't just toss out Dave Grohl wanted to stroll in to make a movie. He made an incredible movie here.
He did. He made an amazing movie about the studio.
About Sound City and the history. And you guys should check that movie out because it has a little bit of all of us in it. If you love music, it's we're in it. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
He ended up playing on the stage.
Man, he was so gracious. I called him up. He's like, send me the track. I'll check it out. And then he emailed me back a couple days later. And he's just like, I love it. This band's amazing.
Wow.
That's cool. Great. I'll come down and do it. And
that's cool.
He came down one day, rolled in. Just blew right through the song and killed it in the most amazing way, as you would expect him to do. And I remember when he finished the song, he stands up and he goes, how many more songs do you guys have? And it was the first song of the record.
Right.
He's like, I think I have 12. He's like, we better get going.
I know.
Yeah. And so over the course of 2 or 3 sessions, he came in and just pounded the record out, no pun intended.
Yeah.
But amazing. I can't say enough about is everything you would think it is and more. Like, he's
one of my favorite
ridiculous.
Drum tracks is Queens of the Stone Age. I can't remember the name of the song.
No one knows.
Where was that recorded?
Over at Eric Valentine's studio.
Eric, that's right. I knew that.
Barefoot.
I was just over there.
And
we were out in the live room. That's where Dave did the drums for that project.
Yeah, right in the same spot right there. But yeah, just incredible. And a lot of the footage from that session is in the Sound City movie. Anytime he's playing in here, we kind of doubled up while we were tracking the record. He had his guys come in and film some stuff.
An amazing contribution, that movie, to really educating and the awareness, and just to see his passion for the story, you know, of this,
I know.
This facility.
There's a couple of things that when I get a little down or things gang up on me, I like that movie. Is going to be my new go-to thing. But the old Tom Dowd movie that was out a few years ago, that changed my life. Have you seen that?
It's a great movie, yeah.
You guys need to check out. It's I forget what it's called, but it's Tom Dowd. You can't miss it. It's a great DVD.
So, Kevin, tell us how you use your DAW rig, your Pro Tools. You got a clasp over there. How do you incorporate that in your realm?
Well, I like to record to tape most of the time because I like the sound of tape. The Scully tape machines I use, I really enjoy. I like the sound of them. But Chris Estes at Clasp has come up with the Clasp, which is a great invention. I didn't really use Pro Tools too much before that. Mm-hmm. What it allows me to do is record the tape and simultaneously take the signal off the repro head and archive it in the computer. And if you're overdubbing, obviously he's come up with a way to delay the rest of the track so the repro head lines up with everything else. Sorry if I'm confusing people. So what Pro Tools is to me in my world is what I always envisioned it being. It's a super high-powered editor and archiver. Yeah. And so everything I do is obviously archived to Pro Tools, and then I can edit if I need to. Mm-hmm. But the sound of everything is the tape machine and goes to the tape machine. Okay. And that's kind of how I like to interface with it. I mean, how do you use Pro Tools in your world?
Oh, my gosh. Can I ask you one question before we get to that?
Sure.
I thought this was not my interview. Do you ever find yourself recording to the Scully and then transferring it to Pro Tools? Is that an option, or do you like to keep tape and digital?
That is an option, because sometimes I'll have a band in here and we'll just use the Scully, and then maybe after the record's recorded, I'll archive it to Pro Tools.
Do you lose anything or gain anything?
I don't think you lose anything. I think with the newer converters we're using now, mm-hmm. I think they sound really good, and I don't really hear any loss. If anything, I've used tape for years now. I've experienced loss from staying on the tape machine, as you know, because the high end starts going away at some point as you're overdubbing. Mm-hmm. Up until a couple years ago, I would say I think we're getting some weird artifacts, but I think the converters are to a certain point where they're transparent.
The dynamic range that we have in the digital world is... Mm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's like
pretty big.
It's great to get the limitations of tape and then put it in that wider bandwidth world.
If I had to work in here, I would have the time of my life. It would just be an incredible experience. But it would be a very limiting experience for me. In my world, I rarely get less than 100 tracks, sometimes 200 tracks. Right. And I'd love to try. Chris Lord-Alge, Tom Elmhurst, a couple of guys talk about before they even try to mix, they try to limit it to a handful of tracks. Mm-hmm. And I would love to try that and see if I could funnel 200 down to 16. And I think I could. And I think because essentially right now, technically I'm funneling 200 down to 2. So 16 would be a step up.
Right.
And... I've done mixes before at Larrabee where I would send stems to the console. So I would send a stereo background to the console, then I'd send maybe four kick and snare separate, and then everything else in the drum track stereo. So I end up with like six to ten stereo tracks going into that console.
Right.
A limitation for me would be the fact that I don't have stereo input, so... So if I've got 16 inputs, I've only got 8 stereo inputs.
Right.
And I'm not real good at working in mono, because mono was something I never liked, and I came into the world of audio near the end of mono. So
this isn't mono.
I know, but what I'm saying is it's harder for me to get like if I have 200 tracks, probably 80 of them will be stereo tracks.
Right.
So it eats up a lot of real estate on the console.
Yeah. Right.
I find myself a lot now staying in the digital domain from conception to when it hits the person's ears. So I'm mastering digitally, and it seems to work for the type of music I'm working on. I'd give anything if I could do a record one day with you and I could experience this again, because this is the world I came from. I learned on a 16 channel Electrodyne board. I had left, center, right. The EQs were so archaic. It was a little switch. I could select 3 or 4 frequencies and then cut or boost.
Yeah.
The one thing it had was the outputs were going through a couple of 55-34 amp gain stages, so that it had the output of that console was so bad, and so we modified that. But I'd love to try it again. I don't think I could do it as good as you. I don't think you could come into my world and do as good as me. But I don't think it's because of our skill set. I think it's because of our taste.
But that's the beauty of it, right?
Well, one of the things that we all have in common is we just love great music. So you ultimately want to end up with something coming out of the speakers back at you that gives you the feeling of those early records you heard.
Right.
And so you just sit there and you mess with it, you mess with it. And then at some point, when you hit playback, usually after an hour break, you go, damn, I'm feeling this. I like this. Now I've got a foundation, tighten it up a little bit, go home, you're done.
Yeah.
You can't get better than best.
Well, I think you make that sound pretty easy.
It's a learned, thank you, by the way. The way to start is start with a great production and a great song. That's the roadmap that guides us all in terms of once it reaches here, it tells us where to go, which of the tracks, in his case, which is the 3 or 4 tracks he uses or the 200 I use.
Yeah.
and so the reason I'm such a big fan of Kevin's is because the song is the roadmap for everything he does. And I'm a I masquerade as an engineer, but I'm a song person. I just love music. And I can still put on songs I heard a week ago and they just move me. I sometimes I'm driving down the freeway and I have to pull over because I can't listen and drive at the same time. And that still happens to me daily. There's great music being made now. It's a little harder to find, a little harder to root out. But man, there's some incredible stuff. Just going back to Alabama Shakes. I mean, thank God for the internet because that gave us those guys.
Yeah.
I love that girl's voice.
Yeah.
Pop music is a disposable medium. It was never designed to be fine china. It was designed to be paper plates. You eat it, you toss it away. But that doesn't mean you can't make a great paper plate.
I agree.
But it does mean if you're going to sit there and put incredible graphics on this paper plate, you're wasting your time. It's a paper plate.
Right.
China's China, paper plates are paper plates. And there's a world in between where creation is warranted, new ideas are validated. The pop world doesn't do that. And it's just a different world, and there's different tools for different houses that we want to build, you know? Like, would you want a house built entirely with no electric tools?
Right.
Might be interesting.
Right.
And there'd be a need for that in some, like a log cabin, whatever. So I'm not an either-or kind of guy. I love being in this room. I love the feeling. I love the gear. I love what Kevin does with this gear.
Yeah.
I think I could do a pretty good job with it, but it'd take me a minute to kind of retrain my brain, you know?
Yeah, and I think, you know, kind of in closing of all this stuff as we're gone, and actually a pretty amazing full circle here. I think it's just really, you know, everybody has their own taste, and to be able to, I think, Kevin, you made the best statement, is really kind of being the avenue and the conduit for somebody, you know, if it's an artist, whoever it is, anybody in your life, it's just you're giving them the platform to be free. And if that comes from the gear, if it comes from the song, if it comes from all those things and you can put them all together, it's just how do you keep the doors open or open one that just never existed? And I think
we'll
that's
that.
Part of really that's what our mission
well,
is.
Well,
and I think you really nailed it on the head, Kev. I think that was it.
Ditto.
Thanks, guys.
Well done.
All right.
Well done.